Several has come to me from time to time wanting to, for me to speak on the kingdom of God, and I think the angel was the straw that broke the camel's back. He said one time right back, he said, "I wish you'd preach on the kingdom of God." I said, "Well, so many people asking about it, I will do that." I think there's some things we need to understand about the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven are synonymous. We can use those terms interchangeably. And I want to give you a little background to that today, and hopefully it don't bore you. If you'll stay with me in the scripture, we'll hurry through it and turn to Isaiah chapter 7 for starters. Isaiah chapter 7. I want you to all play like today that you're Jews. Now, I'm not talking about spiritual Jews, you're already that. But I want you to play like that you're from Israel. You've heard the term that's been handed down from generation to generation to generation about a king that would be coming. Oksana wanted me to come out and share on the broadcast it's been a month or two ago by now. And I taught on the kingdom of God, and she would stop me throughout my message, and it was kind of an interaction type thing anyway. But she said, "We're still looking for the kingdom." And the Jewish nation, the very few that adhere to God, the God of Israel, are still looking for that. Now, I didn't know when I went to Israel in 1986 that like 85% of the whole nation of Israel is atheist. We've got the American idea they all love God. So I mentioned that, kind of tiptoed through the tulips. I kind of mentioned that to Oksana. She said, "Oh, it's worse than that now. It's higher than 85% that are atheist." And you have the old Orthodox Jews that do believe in the Old Testament. Of course, you have Messianic Jews that believe Jesus is their Savior. But in comparison to the number of Jews, that's small compared to the number of the Israelis that are alive today. But let's go back in time in your mind, play like you don't know anything about Christianity, and you're still living under the Mosaic covenant, and you hear about them talk about a king is coming, and we're going to look at some clues. Would that be all right? Just to look at some clues. There's many, many more. I'm only going to give you about six today from the Old Testament. If you'll turn to Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 10, it says, "Moreover, the Lord spake again to Ahaz, saying, Ask thee a sign of the Lord thy God, ask it either in depth or in height above. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. And he said, Hear ye, O house of David." Now that's Israelis, as we would say today. "Is it a small thing for you to weary men? But will you weary my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a" what? "A sign." Here's the sign. Does that sound familiar? What is it? Yeah, okay. "Here's your sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." All right, there's your sign. Turn to Isaiah chapter 9. Let's start reverse. Verse 6. "For unto you is born, unto us a son is given." Now, this is a prophet prophesying this many, many hundreds of years before Jesus was ever born. This is the same guy that prophesied in verse 7 is prophesying again. "For unto you is born a child, unto us a son is given, and the government." Now, what does that mean to Jewish people? That means a kingdom. I looked it up in the concordance. It says the empire, the kingdom shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government, or the increase of his kingdom, and peace there shall be no what? Now think, you're a Jew. Now listen, until Joyce printed that deal off for us on Wednesday night, the Jews have been at war year after year. I'm telling you what, that's all they knew. At times, 50,000, 100,000 were killed of the Jews at war, constantly trying to be conquered. Now, they hated the Romans. Why? Because they're the one that, and their adversary, the Romans and their allies, are who constantly come against the Jews. So when the prophet prophesied of his kingdom or of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Man, they're probably jumping up and down. Finally, when is this going to happen? When is this coming? Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord's hosts will perform this. They can't wait for this to happen, but those people that lived in that day never did see it. So they passed that on to their children. Okay? Let's look at Isaiah 51. I think if you understand this, it'll help you to understand in the New Testament about the kingdom of God. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 9. Awake, awake, put on strength, O arm of the Lord, awake as in the ancient days and the generations of old. Art thou not it that hath cut Ramah and wandered and wounded the dragon? Art thou not it which hath dried the sea? Now remember, the prophet is reminding them of what happened in their past. Art thou not it which hath dried the sea? Remember when the children of Israel walked through the Red Sea, dry land? The waters of the great deep that hath made the depths of the sea a way for the ransom to pass over. Therefore, when you see the word therefore, you need to go back and see what it was there for. Okay? That's the only way I don't say it. All right. Therefore, the redeemed of the Lord shall do what? Shall return. Now listen, these are people who've been badgered and badgered and badgered and badgered and badgered year in and centuries in and centuries out. Therefore, the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing unto Zion, and everlasting joy shall be upon their heads, and they shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and mourning shall flee away. That's good news to a people that's constantly being conquered. Okay. Go to Isaiah 54. Now I'm just giving you a little taste here. I don't read all of that for the sake of time. Let me see here. Let's start for verse 7. Verse 6. For the Lord hath called thee as a woman forsaken and grieved in spirit, and a wife of youth when thou wast refused, saith the Lord. For a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercies I will gather thee. Now they're hearing some good news. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. For this is as the waters of Noah unto me, for as I have sworn in the waters of Noah shall no more go over the earth, so I have sworn that I would not be wroth with thee, nor rebuke thee. So they're starting to see a little break from a prophet. A little bit of good news, okay? For the mountains shall depart and the hills shall be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord, that hath mercy on thee. O thou afflicted, tossed with tempest, and not comforted, behold, I will lay thy stone to fair colors and lay thy foundation of sapphires. And I'll make thy windows of agates, how you say it? Agates, and the gates of thy carbuncles and all thy borders of pleasant stones. And all thy children shall be what? Taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children. So he's still hearing some good news. In righteousness shall be established. Thou shalt be established. Thou shalt be far from oppression. Oppression's all they'd known. For thou shalt not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come nigh thee, near thee. Behold, they shall utterly gather together, but not by me. Whosoever shall gather together against thee shall fall for thy sake. So they're finally hearing. You know, they're thinking it's going to happen next week. Right? Wouldn't you? You prophet stands and prophesies that. Let me insert something here for the future. And first I'll give you an example. We had a guy in Salem when I pastored there prophesied over me something that I thought would take place in the next week. And I love the guy, so I trusted it. It didn't happen for 15 years. I'd already moved to Kansas City before it happened. So don't throw these things away just because you don't see it tomorrow. When the Lord speaks it, it'll happen. It may not happen in your time frame. And this came to me when he was talking about your house. I'm kind of detouring, but that's all right. I'm just following the Spirit. In the Spirit, whoever's buying that house, sometimes there's got to be some shuffling made. This must have been moved and that moved. And, oh, I understand that. Okay, well, I need to go this direction. That all has to take place sometimes before the whole thing manifests in your lap. It doesn't mean it ain't working, because faith is like a seed. When it's working when the sun shines and when it rains. It's working when it don't look like nothing's coming through the ground, but that little seed is sprouting. That's just an example of how faith works. So we all join together for two people's homes today. So the angels was dispatched. Now, like one angel already had one on the way over here. So that's all right. Whatever the hindrances be, we believe we remove that part of it. Amen. So whatever however much time it takes, you just hang on. In the meantime, go for the ride here, okay? But when a prophet prophesies, doesn't mean it's going to happen tomorrow. Remember that for any future events that we may have here. Because these people think, man, this is going to happen next week. All right. Let's go to Isaiah 61. Same prophet. I mean, he's full of it today. I mean, just he's full of good news to those Jewish people. And the prophet says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, proclaim liberty to the captives, and the openings of prison to them are bound. Remember, all of this has applied to the Jewish people. They'd been bound, they'd been in prison, they had all kinds of things happen. And it goes on to say, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, and to comfort all that mourn. Yippee, great, hallelujah, amen, from their point of view. And to point unto them that mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning. They had been mourning for years. And the garment of praise for the spirit of what? Heaviness, that they might be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. Now, remember, so much of their land had been, every time they had been taken captive, a lot of their places that they had built had been wasted and plundered. And he goes on saying, they shall build the old wastes. They shall raise up the former desolations. And they shall repair the waste cities, the desolation of generations. And strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. They had been feeding strangers' flocks before. And the sons of the alien shall be your plowman and your vine dresser. Finally puts them in the driver's seat, right? You with me so far? But ye shall be named the priests of the Lord. Men shall call you the ministers of our God. Ye shall eat the riches of the Gentiles, and in their glory shall you boast yourselves. And it goes on and on and on. One more word. For your shame ye shall have what? And for your confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore in their land they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. All right. Now, that same identical scripture can be found in Luke 4. Where Jesus takes the book and he thumbs through the pages and he finds what Isaiah had prophesied. Before we get to that, I want you to turn to Matthew 2. Matthew 2. Now, they passing this on to their kids, remember. The redeemed of the Lord is going to return. He's going to set up his kingdom. He's going to wipe out Rome. And we're going to have a kingdom of peace, and it's going to be forever. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, where is he that was born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and come to worship him. Let me insert this. Those three wise men came from Persia, hundreds of miles. And in my research last week, I found out they did about 10 miles a day. So that bright light that led them was up for quite a while. And they figured out if we sleep in the daytime and we travel at night, we'll always have a guide. Because the light was only shining at night. Now, they didn't show up at the manger. Now, our manger scene shows three wise men, but that is incorrect with Scripture. It doesn't matter. They showed up. That's what matters. But he was about 2 years old before they showed up. And they were living in a house. Wasn't it the manger scene? But that's all right. Let's go on. They came to worship. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all in Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and the scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus is written by who? The prophet had said that. And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a what? Oh, that's good news. That shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, see, these wise men are telling Herod, that's what the Old Testament said. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired them diligently what time the star appeared. And he said unto them, he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child, and when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and do what? That's a lie. We'll find out when we read further that was not his intentions at all. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were coming to the manger scene. Oh, and to the what? That's where they saw the young child with Mary, his mother. And they fell down and worshiped him, brought him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. All right. Now, in Luke chapter 4, let's move over to that. No, let's go to Luke 2. Luke 2. You guys are listening good. We'll finish up early today. Luke chapter 2. What do I want in Luke 2? Luke 2. Okay, in chapter 2, we find the birth of Christ again, and how the angel appeared, and then a whole group of angels appeared with him, and they were singing, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men, and so forth. And then the shepherd went to meet the baby in the manger. They did go to the manger. But in verse 25, what I want to single out, when they brought Jesus, they brought him to the temple and said, behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And the same man was just and devout, waiting for the what? Consolation of Israel. And the Holy Ghost was upon him. He was waiting. He knew something in his heart. So there's going to be a baby born, and it'll be while I'm living. And the consolation meant there's something about this king that's going to be born that he's going to be exhorting, the concordance said, and giving advice. He's going to beseech those Israelis or the Jewish people. He's going to beg them to understand the kingdom. And to this day, 2015, many of the Jewish people are still struggling with that. And in chapter 4, we've seen Jesus was taken, he's already grown now, he's in the wilderness being tempted of the devil. And verse 14 said, and Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. Well, let's look at 13. And when the devil had ended all the temptations, he departed from him for a season. And Jesus returned after that, I'll add that in, after all that temptation, in the power of the Spirit into Galilee. Now, understand, we're still going to hear a lot about the devil yet. Jesus had not been crucified yet, okay? He returned the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him throughout all the region round about, and he taught in the synagogues, being glorified by who? All. Okay. Being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, as his custom was. He went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. Let me just insert here. I don't know if anybody here needs this or not, but just in case you bump into somebody that needs it. Why do we worship on Sunday and not on Saturday? Anybody know? Yes. I had a neighbor one time said, you guys worship on Sunday because you believe in the sun god. And I said, has nothing to do with it. Has nothing to do with it. It's on the morrow after the Sabbath. I said, technically, now you could we ought to worship God every day. 7 days a week ought to be a worship coming from us. But we go to meet on Sunday because it's based on the resurrection. Has nothing to do with the sun god. Has nothing to do with that. And we've got people, our Pentecostal friends, that worship on Saturday. When I pastored at Salem, we had the fellowship with that church over at St. James that they call, what do they call themselves? Seventh-day Church of God. They believe in worship on Saturday, but they come to our meetings on Sunday. But we used to take a bus over there to go back and forth to their churches, back and forth. Great people. But they worship on Saturday, and I have no problem with that. I wouldn't care if somebody wanted to take out Friday and do it. You know, it doesn't matter. All days are holy unto the Lord nowadays, okay? But I just want to add that because some people say, well, Brother Mike, maybe we better start worship on Saturday. Well, what we do. And Sunday and Monday and Tuesday. Okay. All right. And he went, and he came to Nazareth where he'd been brought up, and as his custom was, he went to synagogue on Sabbath day, which is Saturday, and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. They're saying, amen, yes. The Pharisees probably was even agreeing with this. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. We've been really brokenhearted over the years. Man, that's good news. And to preach the deliverance to the captives. Oh, that's great news too. And recovering a sight to blind and set at liberty them who are bruised. And to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Man, they might have jumped out of their seats then. The synagogue was probably full. And he said, the Lord's anointed me to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, to the Jews, that meant more to them than it seems like it would to us. Because the acceptable year of the Lord was every 50 years they had a jubilee. And the jubilee was a year that they could go free. Now, we're programmed by TV and that Jews are all rich. But evidently that wasn't the case in many cases, because many of them went bankrupt and they served somebody else. Well, on the year of Jubilee, those that they were in debt to had to free them of that debt, write the debt off, paid in full. Plus, in my research, they had to set them back up in business. So for Jesus to stand in the synagogue and say, "He's anointed me to preach this," was good news any way you slice it. He's anointed me to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, which was the year of Jubilee. And then he closed the book and sat down. And he closed the book and gave it again to the minister and sat down. And the eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were what? Fastened on him. I mean, he had their undivided attention. Nobody was making a sound. They were listening. What's he going to say next? And he began to say, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears." Now they sunk back down in their seats, and indignation started rising up, because Jesus was saying, "It's not a year anymore. I'm your Jubilee." Go down to verse 28 and see what they... Hey, after all these amens and hallelujahs and praise God and jumping out of their seat and saying, "This is great," verse 28, "And all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with what? Wrath, and rose up and thrust him out of the city and led him to the brow of the hill where their city was built as a cliff, that they might cast him down headlong." Why would that be so bad for him to say, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears"? Because it had nothing to do with their debt. It did really, they didn't realize it. But Jesus saying, "Don't look for a year anymore. I'm your Jubilee." Then they were filled with wrath and are ready to kill him. In the previous chapter, once the temptation is over, verse 14, Jesus says he returned the power of the Spirit. But what I want to say was, when Jesus started preaching, those Jewish people were so mad they wanted to kill him. But Jesus went on preaching and teaching in their synagogue. But the first thing he did was healing folks. All manner of diseases. And we're on Luke 4 now, aren't we? Yeah. I already read. Let's look at... we already read verse 28, 29, and verse 30. "But he passing through the midst of them..." Did I already read that? "And he passing through the midst of them went his way and came to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and taught them on the Sabbath days, and they were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with what? Power." Now we find now the Jews becomes his worst enemy. All through the Old Testament, they're looking forward to this king coming, because he's going to wipe out the Romans. He's going to set up his kingdom, and of course they'll be in charge. I'm not putting the Jews down. I'm just telling you historically what happened. They're thinking we're going to have a king. It's going to set up in Jerusalem. That's where our capital is. They're still fighting over that to this day. The United Nations has set Tel Aviv as their capital, but they still expect in Jerusalem to be. I don't care about that. That has no relevance to me personally. It may in the scheme of things for them. But they're expecting this headquarters to be in Jerusalem. So now that Jesus is saying, and we found in Romans 14:14, he said it's the kingdom of God is not what? Meat and drink. In other words, it's not meat offerings and drink offerings like he used to do in that kingdom. but it's righteousness, it's peace, and it's joy in the Holy Ghost. What Jesus came to do was to set up a spiritual kingdom. They're still struggling with that today. The kingdom of, they were expecting him to set up in Jerusalem. You know, in John chapter 1, let's move over to John chapter 1. We're about ready to close here. I'm just wanting to set this up for next week. We're going to look at some bunch of stuff, what the kingdom is like. It says in verse 11, he came unto his own, and his own did what? Received him not. But as many as received him, that was Jew or Gentile, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Oh, that, you know, we don't understand the impact that that would have on the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all the people that were in the hierarchy of the Jews then. That's just total opposite what they're looking for. He's included the Gentiles. He's included everybody. Paul comes along later and he says, God was in Christ reconciling the whole world to himself. Anytime a scripture like that comes up, it's just like pushing the Jews back again. Their mindset still expecting Jesus to come and set up his kingdom in Jerusalem. It was a tremendous struggle for the Jewish nation as a whole to accept the life and ministry of Christ, because in the kingdom of God, it was healing the sick, cleansing the leper. That's the way the kingdom worked. I was thinking this week a lot about Joseph and Mary, all being led by a dream. Some was led by a star. Some was led by a light. But that's all they had then. When Jesus comes on the scene, it's something down, we would call it innate in us, inside of us, that speaks to a guy in the nighttime and says something to the Higginbothams. It's by his spirit. It's by his spirit. It's by his spirit how he leads us and guides us. It's by his spirit how and how he works. It's by his spirit that Carol's talking to Jim about this on the way to service tomorrow. By his spirit, he led her to sing that song that blessed us all. Amen? Amen. It's by his spirit. The Jews still can't hardly grasp that. The Messianic Jews can. But even the Messianic Jews, a lot of them are still looking for Jesus to come to the Mount of Olives. They didn't believe him when he was there the first time. He was all over the Mount of Olives many times, and they didn't believe him. So, you know, it's a struggle to get the Jews to move to that position in their thinking, because it's all the kingdom of God is all about a nation with a king and rulers under that. The rulers he has is the Holy Spirit. I was thinking this morning as one of the songs we sing, Brian, I think, mentioned about one of you said it, and I can hear it. Yeah. What's the last of that? That's, I cry, holy, 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 and what's the last? I want to see you. That stuck in me when he said, I want to see you. And I wanted to step up the mic and say, just look around. Just look around. You don't see God? Here they are. There they are. There they are back there. Here they are. God is now tabernacled in a people. And it's hard even for some of us. We just come into an understanding of lately, and you know, the last few years, that there is a deposit of God in everybody everywhere. That's a struggle for me. Because those rotten sinners need to go to hell and burn. That's what it was taught. And I thought it sounded right. Because they're always cursing God and, you know, don't want to go to worship place. And they don't want to, you know, they may play music all night long in the honky-tonk, but they wouldn't give God a minute. They need to go to hell. That's my, it was a philosophy, it wasn't a, but you know, there's a deposit of God in that. And if we'll hang on to that belief and understanding, we'll start seeing some of those folks come around. I heard a man saying, I told this several years ago, a comedian. He was interviewed by somebody on a radio, XM radio. And he said, have you always been funny? Have you always wanted to be a comedian? He said, no, not at all. Ever since I was a little boy, I wanted to be a preacher. But nobody believed in me. And when he said that, the Holy Spirit, that we've been talking about, that's in us, said to me, I've got thousands of people over here in the wings just waiting to come forth when the church will start recognizing it. There are many of them going to be musicians, and some will be actors, and some, you know, involved in the arts, all kinds of things. They're just waiting. Right now, we're sending them all to hell. And I'm using other ways. But when the church releases that, they'll come forth, and they'll do exploits. I'm just so glad that we're coming to an understanding. The kingdom is now. It started with Jesus. We'll get into it maybe more a little next Sunday. The upper room experience was a blast off of that kingdom of God. It's not coming to Jerusalem. Sorry. There may be things happen there. I'm not saying that. But I'm telling you, the kingdom of God is here. It's here now. Can I go one step further and you not kick me out? We don't have no cliffs here to throw me off of, so I'm safe there. We're in the millennium now. While preachers won't mention it, you hear that on the news. You know, when Christians wouldn't accept the word charismatic back in the 60s, you heard that on the news. You'd hear the news say, he's a charismatic speaker. Might be talking about a politician or whoever. He's a charismatic speaker. And I just thought way back then, God, you got a way of getting these terms out here in the world. Just out here in the cosmos. There's Pentecostal denominations that's had national and international conventions just to discuss that. And I'm not telling you something I'm guessing at. I'm talking about people who've called me and said, I just come for convention, and this is what we discussed. Can we say the word charismatic? That seems to me so immature or kid-like or elementary thinking, you know? I hear some things now that just, it sets me back. Has any of you pulled up Barbara Simons you forgot? She says some powerful things, just sets me back. I know her. I've talked to her quite a bit, so I know where her heart is, but the way she says it, it's so out of the box. It just makes me hang on. But it's good. It's good. She wrote a book called Escaping Christianity and Finding Christ. That sounds like a slam against the gospel, but when you understand what she's saying, you know, sometimes our Christianity really holds us back because we're so bound by traditions. People, we've lost people here because they don't want to go any further. They're held in captivity and bondage by the old law. And, you know, you read about this. Paul says the law gives muscle to sin. It don't say it that way. It says the law gives strength to sin. Well, we preach against sin. So why go back to the law? It just gives sin. You know, let me say it another way. The more you preach about sin, the more people do it. It raises a curiosity. For instance, we'll use Matt Cain, Golden Angie's youngest boy. Golden says, Matt, he wakes him up and says, I'm going to work. Wake up, I just want to tell you, I've got 14 guns in there in the closet. I've got a 30-06, I got a 30-30, I got 12-gauge shotgun, I got this, I got that. When I leave, whatever you do, don't go out and shoot any of them. I'll give you one guess what Matthew's going to do. He just stirred up his curiosity. He probably just thought, I'll go look at them. But once he got there, there's a shell in this one. That's, you know. Now, I'd say it about Daryl, too. You know, any of your kids would do that. You preach something, and people become sin conscious. So, yeah, I think I already messed up, so what the heck. Here's my point. As I teach, and this, I've gotten calls about this, and I've had to keep my chin up. Why don't you preach against this? Because I want people to be God conscious. If people are God conscious, the things that they should not do, the Holy Spirit will bring that up. They may not honor it for a while. But if you're God conscious, you will. You will listen, and you'll finally do what the Spirit of God says. So I'm bound by that revelation to keep people God conscious. I could preach against a lot of things. But everything I would mention, you already know it. You know? You already know it. I can get up here and preach a whole sermon against drugs and alcohol. You already know that. You know what? There's laws against it. But what we preach, the Bible says, of such there is no law. When you preach Christ crucified, when you preach love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, all those things. The Bible says, of such there is no law. They don't have to write a law against any of that. If Barb is just full of love and mercy and kindness and all that, there's no law against any of that. People kind of like that, matter of fact. But then the other stuff I could mention, there's laws against it already, and we know them. Why bring it up? I want everybody to be God conscious. God conscious. Conscious of God. When you lay down and sleep at night, I want you to be conscious of God. When you work on your job and you got a time to think about the situation in your family or your work time or whatever, I want you to be conscious of God. I remember a case when Chase and Michelle first started coming. And I'm trying to use Chase's words as close as I can. And if I mess it up, you just stand up and tell me how it really was. But he was going through some things, and he represented a kid. No, represented a guy that was guilty of something. Chase said he really didn't know any scriptures. But he went out the parking lot, grabbed a hold of the door handle of his car, and screamed out, "My God is mighty!" That's being God conscious. He may not at that time knew one scripture to quote, but he knew God was mighty. My God is mighty. I may be in a turmoil in situations, and I don't know which way to go, but my God is mighty. This may happen and that may happen and I don't know what to do, but my God is what? Mighty. This is happening in my marriage and that's happening in my marriage, but this one thing I know, my God is mighty. My finances may not be where they ought to be, but I know this much, my God is mighty. Ain't that wonderful? That's being God conscious. When you're darkness conscious, it's, what am I going to do? How are we going to make it? That's what that other consciousness does to us. I don't know how I'm going to make it out of this. Oh my, they just said I've got this and I've got 2 months to live or 14 days to live or what, or 14 years or 10 years or whatever. What am I going to do? That's what the spirit of darkness conscious does for you. The world says, when you says, I'm healed by stripes of Jesus, they say, no, you're in denial. That's because that's the way they think. No, I just choose to speak something that is not yet as I already was. That's why God called Abraham the father of faith, because he believed in something that actually hadn't happened yet as though it already had. He was 25 years before he got the baby when God said he'd have a son. 25 years went by. So what did God do to him? Change his name. So every time he come out of his tent, all of his neighbors called him Abraham. They were all saying, Father of many nations. Hello, Father of many nations. He got everybody in the community saying it just by calling his name. You know, if we'll just do that always. Speak those things that you can't see. Because that's the way the kingdom of God works. When you can't see it, you can't feel it, you can't taste it, you can't hear it, but we say what God says about it, because we're God conscious. The result says it'll be all right. It'll be all right. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You got a song, Carla? That's all right. Go for it. Thank you, Jesus. Let's stand. Oh, yes. By his word. This cannot follow me. By his word have me victory. By his word I am set free. By his word I have no fear in him. By his word victory. By his word I've been set free. By his word I am no fear in him. By his word death cannot follow me. By his word set free. By his word I have no fear in me. By his word they not follow me. By his word I walk in victory. By his word, I've been set free. Amen. Hallelujah. Hope we get a little bit of understanding how the Jews thought about the kingdom and how they were highly disappointed when it wasn't that way. They're disappointed today, a lot of them, because they're still looking for that to happen. He's already come. He's already set up his kingdom. but he sets us up not in Jerusalem, but in here, in the hill of our heart. Amen. God bless you. A wonderful congregation. I hope it meant something to you for next Sunday. And the Bible, just especially the New Testament, just says the kingdom of God is like this, and the kingdom of God is like that, and the kingdom of God is like, there's just so many parables there. Surely we can get one of them. Amen? Or two. Bill?
Last Wednesday night, we heard a speaker by the name of Jamie Englehart. Some of you heard it. It was tremendous. There are some people that are not here that have been here for some time. They left because they were offended by what somebody said or by what somebody did. If they would hear this message and put it into practice, they wouldn't have left. They would be here today. You know, that's a burden on my heart that they're not here. I really haven't heard much prayer exhibited on their behalf that they would reconsider and come back to our fellowship. At this season of the year, I would encourage us to pray for them that their heart will be touched. I have three copies here of that message last Wednesday night. If you want a copy, you're welcome to it. Hey, Pastor? If you want a copy and I don't have a copy, I'll get you a copy. 2 are gone, 1 left.
This Friday, Saturday evening, we'll be going to the Raymore Rehab nursing home to sing some songs, Christmas carols for the people there, residents. Anyhow.
Now you know how I feel when I can't think of a word.
This Wednesday, when you come, some of us are baking cookies and fixing for each one of those. And as you come Wednesday evening, if you could bring just one small bag of some kind of candy, but they have to be soft. I'm thinking of like little individual wrapped, like Reese Cups, or those chocolate bells, or those little candy.
But nothing with nuts in it, right?
No peanuts.
There's no nuts of anything.
Okay. We'll pick those out. If you could bring those, and we're working on some little deals to put the cookies in and the candy to give each one of those residents. If everybody will bring just one more bag of candy, that would be really helpful. Okay? What time? 6:30?
We're going to start singing at 6:30. Or thereabouts.
If you want to come a little bit early, I think they said we could help push the ones out in their wheelchairs. So let's go and just have a good time and share our love with those people. Wednesday night will be potluck. Bring whatever you want to bring for food to the service.
6 o'clock. I see promptly at 6. All right. Tell your friends, bring them along too. They might enjoy it. Okay? 6 o'clock for Wednesday night, but 6:30 Saturday night. Okay?
Saturday.
Saturday night. Okay? All right. Does anybody not know where that rehab place is in Raymore? Okay. It's, I tell you.
6011 Sunrise Drive.
If you're coming.
I'll put it on the church website. There you go. Church Facebook.
I didn't even know we had a website. I didn't even know we had a cafeteria.
Sandra just whispered to me, if you don't have time to go to the store, you don't want to go to the store, give us a buck or two, and we'll be glad to pick up the candy for you.
There you go. All right.
All right. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.